Heavenly Father God, I just want to thank you for this amazing day. Thank you for the sunlight. Thank you for the flexibility of moving the chairs under the shade, Lord Jesus. Thank you so much for bringing us all here today to celebrate you and to worship you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today we're going to be looking at a particular message. It's actually probably one of the most difficult messages for me because I had to do a lot of research on it. If you're new here today, or if you want to know where we're at with this series, we're doing a series called Life Healing Choices, and it's looking at 8 choices that we can do in our lives to help better our lives and help us recover from our spiritual hurts, habits, and hangups. And so we're at step 3, which is consciously choosing to commit all my life and my will to the Christ care and control. For the past 2 weeks, we've been looking at the 5 barriers to making that full commitment to Christ. You guys remember what those 5 barriers were? Pride, guilt, fear, worry, doubt. Those are the 5 main barriers, and those are the things that get in the way for us to fully commit our lives and will over to Christ. But the Bible says in Matthew 5:5, happy are those who are humbled. Humility is the only way to really fully be used by God. If you're prideful in any way, then that's going to get in the way. That's going to get in the way of you making that full commitment. And then step 3, it says we made a decision to turn our lives and wills over to the care of God. Romans 12:1, it says, therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Now that's where we want to get to. Many of us are not there yet. Or maybe we do it sometimes, but not all the time. When it comes to giving our bodies and turning our bodies and doing those things, we have to remember that that is a daily thing. That's a daily commitment to God. And there's a lot of barriers. We talked about, you know, the past 2 weeks, a lot of barriers to it, especially pride and guilt. Those are the top big ones I think we talked about a couple weeks ago. But fear, worry, doubt, these are things that are infiltrating our minds, and it's really hard to focus on an all-perfect God and to turn our lives and wills over to God when those things are getting in the way. So hopefully you guys last week were able to make somewhat of a diagnosis on yourself to where you're at with this whole thing and where you're at with this recovery process. But today, we're going to start a 2-week series on what to do, the steps that are necessary for you to commit your life to Christ. It's a very important message, and the more I researched my particular portion of this message, the more difficult it was for me, because I know how hard it was for me to do this. But not just me, it's human nature to be hesitant of giving our whole lives and wills over to Christ. Now this first area, the number one, the first thing on your notes, if you look at your notes, it says, I accept Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. Now you're thinking, I've heard that before. I've heard many pastors do that, many priests talk about that. I've heard it on TV. I've heard it talked about many, many times. Yeah, we have. But the problem is, we don't do it. We hear it, but we don't do it. Or we think we did it, but we never fully made that choice to commit our lives and wills to Christ's care and control, but to accept Jesus as our Lord and our Savior. Now in Acts 16:31, it says, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. And then Romans 10:9, it says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Here's the problem. We don't know what that means. We think that, okay, it's enough to believe. Just believe. Like giving God credence. Like giving God acknowledgement that Jesus is the Son and, you know, Son of God. That he came. Just acknowledging that, right? Like I can tell you, yeah, that's a building. That's a building that you guys are sitting under right now. But what's the problem with that? There's no action. All we're doing is just saying, yeah, acknowledging that Jesus is our Lord and Savior. Is that enough for salvation? No, it's not. And I'll explain to you why. You see, some will say all you have to do is believe in Jesus as your Lord. And there's 4 verses that I'm going to read to you really quick that basically people think that all you have to do is believe. And they say, believe in Lord Jesus and you shall be saved, you and your household. That's in Acts 16:31. Romans 3:22 says, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe, for there is no distinction. Ephesians 1:19 says, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power towards us who believe? And then the last one, Philippians 1:29. report to you it has been granted for Christ's sake to not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake. You see, people misread those verses. They think, okay, I'm just going to give credence. I'm just going to acknowledge God as our Lord and Savior, and that's enough. It's not enough when you really dissect those verses, when you really meditate on those verses. Now, to understand what that means, you have to look at what the definition of believe is. It's a Greek word from the term pisteo, which is, means to believe, also to be persuaded, and hence to place confidence in, to trust in. It signifies in the sense of the word reliance on. No mere credence, no mere acknowledgement. It's an action verb. It's an action. It's not just a thought. It's an action. It's a noun. Not just a noun. You see, if you're placing your confidence in God, in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you're placing your confidence, then you are relying on him. You are trusting him. You're not just giving him credence. Then you will make him Lord and Savior of your life. Now, there's a difference between Lord and there's a difference between Savior. I'll explain that in a second. But if you look, actually, if you look at your notes, you'll see Savior. The definition, I looked this up from the Webster's Dictionary online. Here's what it says on your notes. It says, one that saves from destruction, one who brings salvation. Now, God can save us from different things. He can save us from eternal damnation. That's what it means to salvation. But he can also save us from ourselves, our tendencies, our way of life, what we do, the mistakes that we make over and over and over again. And we all need a Savior for that. If we cannot change, if we are having difficulty changing on our own willpower, then we need a God to save us from ourselves. Or maybe we need a God to save us from our circumstances. Maybe our circumstances are so horrific and it's taking a toll on our lives. We need a Savior to come in and to save us. You see, it's not just eternal damnation. It's saving us right now. It's saving us here today. We need a Savior to do that today. And then you look at your notes, it says Lord. Lord, the definition of Lord, is one having power and authority over others. This actually comes from the old English term, which means to have ownership of property, you're a lord of that property and then the possessions in there. It's a ruler. It's an owner of land or property, a head of household, I guess you can say. So a Lord and Savior are different things, are different definitions. So 8 times in Scripture, it says that Jesus is to be Lord and Savior. It uses the two together, Lord and Savior, 8 times. And 5 out of the 8 verses in the Bible are from Peter, of all people. Peter. If you guys know anything about Peter, he was very self-willed. And I'm just going to read you a few of his verses. He says, for in this way, the entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, will be abundantly supplied to you. And then he also says in 2 Peter 2:20, it says, for it after they have escaped the defilements of the world by the knowledge of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and are overcome. The last state has become worse for them than the first. And then he says, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be glorified both now and to the day of eternity. He's trying to tell us something, Peter. He's trying to basically tell us that we can't just have God as our Savior, and we can't just have God as our Lord. We need him for both. We need to have him be both roles in our lives. If we try to just have him as your Savior, it's not going to work. If you try to just have him as your Lord but not accept him as your Savior, it's not going to work. You have to have both. You have to have both. Now, here's some verses on, and it's not on your notes, but verses that it's basically warning us that it's not enough to just call him, verbally call him Lord. It says this in Matthew 7:21. It says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. You see what I'm trying to get? It's a heart issue. It's always a heart issue. If you acknowledge God as your Lord and Savior, and you really mean it, then your actions will follow. They call it working out your salvation. That's what the Bible calls working out your salvation. In Acts 2:36, it says, therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, thus Jesus, whom you crucified. And then Romans 13:14, it says, be put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts. You see, there's benefits to having God as your Lord and your Savior. There's major benefits to it. You see, when you do that, when you allow Him to do His work in you, you will start to see change that you've never seen before. You will start to have a power in your life that you've never experienced before. You'll start to make decisions, good decisions, that you've never been able to make before. You'll be able to withstand the temptations that you never were able to withstand before. You will be able to change your life in ways that you never thought were possible. That is our God, and that's what He's here to do. He's in the business of changing lives. He's not just a concept. He's not just a philosophy. And He's more than just our Lord, our Savior, to giving us a home in heaven. That's the problem. We just think, okay, I got to turn my life over to God so I can have a home in heaven. You see, it's very, very, very important that you know that there is a distinction between that thinking and the way God wants us to think. You see, there's a term that's called foxhole salvation. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of this term. It's basically when we come to God when we're under fire. When we come to God when we only need something from Him. We call out to Him when we're in desperate need. And that's it. That's it. That's called foxhole salvation. He's not our Lord. We just come to Him when needed, like a genie in a bottle, right?
Yeah.
Rub the lamp and here comes God. Okay, help me with this, God. That's how we treat God. Another reason why we only really accept Him as our Savior and our Lord is that we're never taught that we need to accept Him as our Lord. We only think that a Savior is that that's it. But they were never taught that He must also be our Lord. And people also, when they read the Bible, they misinterpret it. You know, they choose to ignore what the Bible teaches. They find the verses on what they want to find for to justify their lifestyle. We do that. But there's more to being a Christian than doing it. He can actually help come into our lives, and He can change it from the inside out. He can make the necessary changes in our lives that we need to make. You know, the reality is that some people don't want to go to hell, but they want to keep their hellish behavior. Right? They don't want to go to hell. They don't like that part, but they want to keep their hellish behavior. We've heard the statements, yes, I want Jesus as my Savior, but I will not give up my smoking, my boozing, my fornicating. You see, the problem is with that, is that some unknowledgeable Christians, I guess you can say, come along and say, it's okay to accept Jesus as your Savior and He'll take care of the rest, right? We think that that's true. Yeah, it's true to a certain degree, but we have to give Him permission to take care of the rest. He's not just going to automatically take care of the rest if we acknowledge Him as our Lord and our Savior. We have to give Him permission to enter into our lives and to change, make the changes that He wants to make. That only happens when we make Him our Lord and Savior. Not just say it, but follow it. You know, on your notes you'll see, how do I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior? Now this is probably, that's why this is a difficult message for me. Because a lot of us get stuck with the concept of separating Lord and Savior, the whole deal. Like, how do we do that? I found something online. I thought it was really cool. You'll see it. It's your bigger sheet there. It says, apply CPR. How to apply CPR. You guys know what CPR is?
Mm-hmm. The
physical. It's basically resuscitating somebody that's choking or that you know, they're not breathing, right? You're bringing them back to life. Right. We need to come back to life spiritually and emotionally and physically. A lot of us are dead inside. We're just existing. We need to be alive. We need to have CPR in our lives. So I printed this out because I wanted you guys to learn what that means to have CPR, to come alive, to really accept Lord Jesus as your Lord and Savior, but not just to do it like mentally, to actually live it out and make decisions that you need.